Welcome to Fairhaven Baptist Church and the commencement exercises for Fairhaven Baptist Academy and College. While we're here for commencement exercises, it is the commencement of a school and a college that is part of a church, and this is a church service. We need to be respectful. Please refrain from walking in and out, answering cell phones. Please make sure they're turned off. Taking pictures, video, or disturbing the service in any way. There will, of course, be plenty of time to take pictures later. You will hear some musical performances. Students will be receiving awards, certificates, diplomas, and degrees. Some students will be giving testimonies of how God helped and strengthened them during their time of schooling. It's appropriate to congratulate the students at the proper time, but if you'd like to praise God with them, a hearty amen is a good way to do that. Please stand with me now as we sing our national anthem.
Pastor Armacost in just a moment is going to come and open our commencement service in prayer. And as Dr. Vogelin mentioned, if you could just observe with us, it's a church service, and especially with the college, we train preachers. And so, as he said, a good hearty amen is good, except will we have a time where they can clap for the graduates?
Yes.
All right, there will be a time when you can clap for the graduates instead of when they come across, say, amen. That would be kind of weird. We understand that. And then he did mention about leaving and things like that, but this is a longer service. We understand that. And so there is a, we added an offering since it's a preacher service. So we have an offering, and then we will have a congregational song. So if the needs arise to fly to the restroom, we will. We have a spot there because it does get lengthy, and we'll make a little break for you in the towards the middle of the service. Pastor Armacost, why don't you open in prayer?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time we can come together, Lord, and really remember a lot of work, a lot of prayer that really is represented by an evening like this. Lord, we consider our country and the world, Lord, and certainly we know of the great need for young men and young ladies of character and determination to go into this world and to take a stand for you and for right. Lord, we know as time goes on, that's going to prove to be more and more difficult. And so, Lord, I do pray that you would watch over each of our graduates this evening as they step out and serve you in various places really around the world. We ask God that you would go before them, and Lord, that you would help them to understand the importance of staying near to you and staying close to you and being determined to finish their course with joy. Thank you for every friend and family member, mom, dad, grandmother, grandfather that's come here this evening. We thank you, Lord, for their support of their relative, Lord, and for joining us here this evening. I pray that they would also receive a blessing here through the service. Thank you for your many blessings, Lord, and I pray that you would again be honored and glorified through what's said and done here this evening. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
While we want to maintain the serious nature of a church service, these are commencement exercises, and most likely you've not heard music like we have planned for tonight in church recently. For many years, we have prepared a special song in three categories for our graduation service. The first category is a patriotic or march selection. We are grateful that God, in His providence, has placed us here in America. And as Americans, we believe it is proper to teach our children to have a Christian view and appreciation for the country that He has given us. Our selection in this category tonight is National Emblem March by E.E. Begley. Begley composed the score during a 1902 train tour with his family band, but became frustrated with the ending and tossed the composition in the trash. The members of his band retrieved it and secretly rehearsed the score in the baggage car. And Begley was surprised when the band informed them just minutes before their next concert that they were going to perform it. It has since become the most famous of all of Begley's marches. He incorporates into the march the first 12 notes of the Star Spangled Banner, played by euphoniums and trombones, and disguised in a different time signature. But all the rest of the notes are his. John Philip Sousa was once asked to list the three most effective street marches ever written. Of course, he listed two of his own compositions first, but also selected National Emblem for the third. National Emblem was the favorite march composition of Frederick Fennell, for who edited this arrangement that we'll be playing in 1981. Fennell called the piece as perfect a march can be. And we'll also close the night with a popular patriotic prayer, God Bless America. Next, we select a classical piece of music to play, and there's a wealth of challenging music that I can choose from to stretch the abilities that God has given us. Our classical selection is an excerpt from the overture to the composition titled The Year 1812 by Peter Tchaikovsky. The 1812 overture is among Tchaikovsky's most famous compositions. He wrote it for a friend who wanted music to commemorate the consecration of the Cathedral of Christ the Savior in Moscow, which was built to mark the Russian victory over in 1812 over Napoleon. They envisioned a grand outdoor spectacle for the audience, so he was inspired to score the work for cannons, a military band, and church bells, in addition to the orchestra. Although the premiere of the Year 1812 overture was actually held in a concert hall without cannons or church bells, it didn't have the firepower it was intended to have. It was still an immediate success. Throughout the overture, Tchaikovsky interjects fragments from the French national anthem to represent Napoleon. He also quotes the Russian national anthem, God Save the Tsar, a Russian Orthodox Church hymn, God Save Thy People, and fragments of a Russian folk song in the opening theme. He used these musical quotations to symbolize the heart and soul of the Russian people. Regarding it, Tchaikovsky complained, "The overture will be very loud and noisy, but I wrote it without any warm feelings of love, and so it will probably be of no artistic worth." Critics have argued over the years over its artistic worth, but it has become a summer staple of orchestras and a continual audience favorite. Staging the work presents us with unusual challenges. Because of the inclusion of cannons in the finale and church bells, the timing of the cannon bursts is crucial, so because he indicated in the score that they were to sound on specific beats. So determining the length of the fuse and lighting it at the precise moment to fire on cues requires an expert. But the cannon featured in our concert is actually one of our percussionists, doing the best he can to recreate the sound on our bass drum. And the church bells are produced by our marimba. So you'll need to use a little imagination there with us. Our final selection is an arrangement of Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken by the prolific band arranger James Ployhar. Originally called Zion, or the City of God, the hymn is an 18th century composition written by John Newton, who also wrote Amazing Grace. The hymn has often been set to music of Joseph Haydn's, which is known as Austria in English-speaking circles. During Haydn's visit to England, he was impressed by the frequent performance of God Save the King. Upon his return home, he felt that the Austrians also needed a patriotic hymn to give them pride in their country, which was taking a severe beating from Napoleon. In January 1797, he created a tune for a short text title. The translation of the title is God Save Emperor France, which was adopted by the people and remained their national anthem for over a century. Haydn's anthem was then taken by the Germans in 1918 and adopted as their own. They changed the words, and the song remained Germany's national anthem through the end of World War II. It's one of Haydn's most popular themes, and the melody is also recognized as our hymn, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. Newton was able to publish the hymn in the Olney Hymns Hymnal in 1779. It is based upon Psalm 87, Isaiah 33, and 60, and is considered by some to be his best composition. The hymn has five verses of eight lines each, and in them Newton speaks of the joy and blessings we have by being the people of God. Now please enjoy our high school orchestra as they play National Emblem March.
Hebrews 13, 5 through 6 says, For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, The Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Hello, my name is Maggie Leake. My family has been attending Fairhaven Baptist Church since my second grade year. Before that, my parents were both bus kids who grew up in Maryland. There, they were saved through the bus ministry and were able to attend Christian academies. But later, they came to Fairhaven Baptist College, where they were met, married, and stayed here for a short time. After that, they were about missionaries in Wales for about 10 years. And while there, they received a wonderful blessing, me. It was in 2005, when I was 7, that we came back to the States. I was enrolled in the academy, and it was about a year later, at a mother and daughter banquet, that I was saved. The speaker was teaching on Jesus having a place in your heart and in your life, and I knew that Jesus had no place in my heart. And so my mom took me out and dealt with me on salvation. She showed me numerous verses, and that night I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. I am not the Christian that I should be, I know that. But I would not be here if it were not for my parents, for whom I am very grateful. I know they're not perfect, but they raised me and they loved and cared for me. But the greatest blessing from them is that I know that they prayed for me to live as God would want me to live. I am also grateful for the teachers and staff here at Fairhaven. I look up to and admire many of them because of their faithfulness and the burden for us to do what is right. I was not always grateful, though, when a teacher or a staff member would mention to me, "Hey, I'm praying for you," or "I'm praying for every one of you in my class by name." I thought they were being hyper-spiritual. Who would pray for all 24 of us? But I've come to realize what a great blessing and privilege it is to have people praying for me. One instance of this was when I was in the 8th grade. Someone very close to me left the church and turned away from God. This was a very hard time for me and very discouraging. But I had looked up to them, but then they were gone. I have forgiven them, but it's hard to lose someone that you love. Throughout this, God showed me the verse, Hebrews 13:5. For he has said, "I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." I know that, yes, people will fail me, but Jesus Christ will always be there. He will never leave me or forsake me. God also was able to use the youth group to impact my life. I did not always enjoy every single activity that the youth workers dreamed up. The one activity ended in a mud fight in the horse pasture. I was not happy as I went home covered in mud. However, the youth group has helped me to grow tremendously. From the big teen trips to the canvassing and the nursing home nights, God was able to use the youth group in my life. He taught me many invaluable lessons, the most important of which was just knowing God. Sure, God was my parents' God. God was this church's God. But God showed me that he needed to be my personal God. I was just floating along. But in my sophomore year, God really began to work in my heart and in my life to show me that I needed to get a real relationship with him. Also, on the big trip last summer out east, God dealt with me about not only knowing him, but having a daily walk with him and a real prayer life, not just rattling off names on a prayer list, but having a real talk with him. God also was able to use my father's work in my life. My father works construction, so his paychecks are not steady. And most of you have heard his stories, but sometimes we would be behind on our mortgage or have no food in the cupboard, or didn't think we would be able to start school. But God would always miraculously work and show us that he was in control. He showed us that he never left us. He never forsook me. Also, the hymns we sing at church are a great encouragement to me. Most of the time, I just sing the notes. But if I stop and think about the words that I'm saying, I am awestruck at what my great Savior does for me and how little I do in return for him. I know I'm not perfect. I still have a lot to learn, but I desire to live for and serve my God. This fall, Lord willing, I will be entering Fairhaven Baptist College to study in the missions program. God has given me a tremendous desire and burden for the missions. I see the need for the missionaries, not only here in America, but also abroad, and I desire to serve him, whether here or on a foreign field. I am grateful that God placed me in my home and in this church, and I'm glad that I received the training and upbringing that I did. I know it will be useful in the future wherever I go. I can't understand why God would want to choose to use me, but I desire to serve him with my whole heart and all my might in the coming years, doing whatever he has in store for me. And I know that wherever I go, wherever he sends me, he will be there with me. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize a few high school students for some of their achievements this year. The first award I'd like to give is the National Honor Society. The criteria for this primarily is academic excellence, not just a good academic record, but an excellent record. Also considered as leadership in the school, in the classroom, in athletics, and other areas. Today I'd like to recognize two students as being inducted into the National Honor Society. The first one is Jennifer Dameron. She should be behind me. She can just stand for a moment. And the other is John Olson. Those two we will induct into the National Honor Society. I'd also like to recognize some students for achievement in particular academic areas. Here we're looking for academic achievement in these areas, as well as a good Christian testimony amongst their fellow students. These students I'm going to ask to come down to the front. We have a certificate to present to them. And at the end, we can give all of these students a round of applause. All right, the first area to recognize someone in is science. And that goes to Maggie Leek. Most of these will be behind me, or to my side in this case. And while she's coming, the math award also goes to Maggie Leek. Her classmates, I don't think, will argue. History is next. That one goes to Juliana Armacost. The next category is Bible. This one goes to Amy Jo Brader. English this year goes to Robert Leek. Speech goes to Jennifer Dameron. The Literature Award this year goes to Sabrina Dameron. She's on the other side. Band this year, the award goes to John Olson. And the last year to recognize is keyboarding. This year, the award goes to Emily Reinhardt. All right, as she's coming, let's give them a round of applause. Maybe so.
Good evening. My name is Lydia Clausen, and I'm from London, Ontario, Canada. It is a humbling privilege to stand before you tonight and give my testimony. Honestly, when I came here 4 years ago, standing up here was the last place I thought I'd end up. You see, even though I was saved before I came here, God has changed everything about the way I view my life. Proverbs 16:9 says, "A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps." The Lord started directing my steps long before I even considered college, even though I didn't know it at the time. In my early teenage years, my two much older brothers moved out from Ontario out west to Alberta, and my parents and I soon followed. Over there, we had a good church, I had good friends, and I was very happy. I thought we'd stay there for the rest of my life. That's when God started changing my parents' heart and directing them to move back, I did not understand. I thought it was wrong. But even then, I now realize that God was just starting to direct my steps, even though I had no idea what he had in store for me. As I've implied already, I grew up in a Christian home. I've been exposed to the best Christian standards, preaching, everything. Everything's been handed to me on a silver platter, if you would say. But even though I was saved when I was very young, my Christian life started to become routine. And my prayer life, my Bible reading started slipping, and my relationship with God was not as it should have been. Therefore, when the time neared that I would choose a college, Bible college was not even on the top of my list. I thought I didn't need it. I had learned everything I thought I needed along my whole life, really. But God had different plans for me. My parents encouraged me to take at least 1 year of Bible college. Well, Fairhaven was not the top of my list, for sure. I had come to Empowered Youth several years. Even though, yes, it was great fun, the absolute craziness of the week persuaded me that this was the last place I could get any peace and quiet for college life. But I came anyway for 1 year at first, I thought, okay, well, I'll get this year over with, then I can do what my plans are. But throughout that year, God really changed my perspective of this place. Staff members, church members, so many people were there to encourage me and help me along, even though I had no idea what I was doing. And above all, this place had a vibrancy and a love for God and for others that I didn't have in my own life, and I saw that I needed that. That's why I decided to come again, and immediately I started praying that God would work in my life, and he did. I started being convicted through chapel messages, sermons, so many different things that I really needed to surrender to God, and I did. That was when he changed everything about my life. The bus kids that I worked with, even though they were so bad, I started to love them. And the people I saw in nursing home every week, I started to love them too, even though they were so grumpy sometimes. And more importantly, my walk with God was renewed, and I loved him so much more than I ever had before. Now, as I graduate here tonight, I look back on that move that I dreaded so long ago, and I realize that God meant it for good. No, I would not have been here, but also I realize I would have made some very, very bad decisions if I would have stayed. One of my best friends there, a pastor's daughter, soon moved out of her house and gave her life to the world. I realized if I would have stayed there, I would have probably been at least influenced by those decisions, but I would have probably made some of them myself. And I'm so grateful that God led me out of that path. I want to thank my parents tonight, for my teachers, my ensemble leaders, so many people who have poured so many hours into my shaping what I am today. I am so excited to graduate tonight. That verse from Proverbs is more applicable to me now than it ever has been before. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. I'm excited as I return home to work in my church there, and I'm more grateful than ever that God is still directing my steps. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is James Swamba, and I'm from Zambia, Africa. I'd like to thank God for giving me the opportunity to come to Bible College here at Fairhaven. I was saved in the year 2003 at the age of 13 through a mission church started by Fairhaven in my hometown of Cowboy. Before we started attending Independent Baptist Church of Cowboy, my family and I attended a local Pentecostal church. Independent Baptist Church of Cowboy was started by missionary Pat Gordon. He's here with us, and I'm thankful for that. And I remember when we first started attending the church, it was one of my older sisters who was invited and visited the church just out of curiosity. She wanted to find out what was all about with the new church in town. When she went that Sunday, she was very impressed with the services. That the next Sunday, she took the rest of us, the children in the house, to go visit that church, attend that church without our parents' permission. When we got there, we enjoyed the services so much, and it seemed like God was real and personal at that church. So as a group, as children in the house, we decided from then on, we would start attending that church no matter what. But when we got back home, things were different. We got in trouble for attending the church without our parents' permission, with my parents. But thankfully, the next Saturday, Pastor Gordon was able to come to visit my parents with another member from the church. And I remember he had a long Bible study with my parents. He answered a lot of questions from the Bible that my parents asked. And I remember my dad telling my mom to gather the whole family in the living room so that we could all hear the word of God. My father had never heard the plan of salvation so clearly as was shown from the Bible. So the next Sunday, my parents decided to visit the church with us, and they also enjoyed the services so much that they decided to start attending that church from then on. Shortly after that, I was saved and baptized, and I started growing in the Lord. After I graduated from high school, I answered the call to preach and started preparing to come to Bible College. In 2009, I was able to attend a Bible Institute started by missionary David Austin, and I'm thankful he's here with us too. And then in 2011, with the help of missionary Adam Rich, who is currently serving in Zambia, I was able to come to college. It's interesting that all three of these missionaries whom God used in my life all graduated from this college, Fairhaven Baptist Church, and here I am graduating from the same college that they went. So I'm very thankful for that. I've been here for 5 years, and I've learned many lessons in the classrooms and in my ministries. God has been faithful to me and has provided me with many wonderful friends and a church family that loves the Lord. And now here I am, ready to graduate to go out and serve. I've been trained and equipped with many lessons. Now it's time for me to go out into the world to serve God. It almost feels like a send-off to battle from the dorm and college life into the battlefield of the world. 1 Timothy 1, verse 17 says, "Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." I thank God that He's eternal and that He has made me a partaker of His eternal spirit. I thank God for saving me. I thank God that He's immortal, and because He lives, I can live tomorrow and I shall never fail if I trust him. I thank God that he's invisible and that I do not have to trust my sight, but I should follow God by faith. There are so many things that I cannot see right now, and also there are many things that I cannot see in the future, but I thank God that I can believe him by faith, that if I follow him, he'll work all things together for my good behind the scenes. I thank God lastly because the only wise God, and I can always trust his counsel. I thank God that I can lean on him and rest assured that his way is the right way with me. And now I can say, like the Apostle Paul said at the end of that verse, unto God my King be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hello, my name is Joshua Barzon. It's amazing what can change in just 4 years. I remember just 4 years ago stepping onto campus as a naive freshman. And I know some of you might think I'm still a naive senior. But I remember coming onto campus being scared, not knowing what God had for my future. And without lying tonight, I stand here once again, not completely sure about what God has for my future again. But I know that God's led every step of my path through this 4 years here, and I have no doubt that he's gonna lead my path again in the future. As I look back on my short life so far, I can truly see that God has been preparing my life for a greater purpose than I could have planned for myself. Tonight, I'd like to take a few moments to share with you a few of the events in my life that God has used to bring me to where I am. Now, the beginning of God's workings in my life, they actually don't begin with myself. They begin with my parents. Begins in the dusty deserts of Saudi Arabia in the 1980s. My dad was working for the State Department at the time, and him and my mother were living on a compound by the Red Sea. My parents both had very good upbringings. They had loving parents. They had good parents that loved them. They had a religious background. But there was still an emptiness in their life that religion couldn't fill, that the pleasures of life couldn't fill. There was nothing that could fill it. My parents knew the Bible was true. They knew that God was real. And they began to pray to God and ask him to show what the truth was to them. It was soon after that God heard and he answered their prayer. God sent a man that had an underground Bible study to invite them to. Now, I don't know how much you know about Saudi Arabia, but there definitely aren't any public churches or freedoms to evangelize over there. It was at this underground Bible study on the compound that my parents heard for the first time that they were sinners guilty of breaking God's law. They heard from a passage that he preached on that says this, "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Now, if you're anything like myself, you don't like to hear about hell and the fiery flames. However, I praise God tonight for a man that cared more about my parents' eternal soul rather than making them feel comfortable in this lifetime. It was soon after that that my parents heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. They heard that Jesus was willing to save them if only they forsook their trust in their own goodness and their own works, and they put that trust in Jesus Christ. It was on that night in the dusty deserts of Saudi Arabia that both of my parents became the children of God. Now, many of you here tonight have heard the expression, actions speak louder than words, and we all know it to be too true. I praise God for a father that personified this expression. I know without a doubt in the world that this is the main reason my father's walk with the Lord that led me to salvation and other greater decisions later in my life. However, as I soon became a teenager, an older teenager even, I found that just like my parents, there was an emptiness in my life as well, and nothing that school could offer me, nothing my friends could offer me, it couldn't fill that emptiness. I remember my father calling me into his room one night, and he told me, he said, "Josh, it seems that you can sin and it doesn't bother you. It seems you can do wrong and there's no repentance in your life." And that convicted me to my heart. That was the Holy Spirit working on my heart. And I remember going back to my room, and the only thought in my mind was, I know what salvation is. It's not complicated. I know who Jesus is. I know there's a heaven and I know there's a hell. I was just too prideful to admit to God that I was a sinner and that I needed Christ. I remember thinking in my mind that if I didn't ask Jesus to save me right then, he might never give me another chance. It was that night next to my bed that I knelt down and I asked Jesus Christ to save me, and he's changed my life since then. Decades later, just as my parents had become the children of God, I as well became a child of God. Now, there's a verse in the Gospel of Mark that says this, For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and loses his own soul? It's from the truth of this passage that God has given me the direction for my future. As the truth of that passage sank deep into my mind, I couldn't escape the deep burden and conviction placed on my heart to preach the gospel. I know personally from growing up overseas in Egypt and also in Saudi Arabia and other foreign fields that the need is great, but those willing to go are few. And sadly, even in America, we see that the truth is whittling down and there's just confusion. People don't know what the truth is. I began to think to myself, how could I, with such a great salvation that I have in Jesus Christ, hide it from those that are wandering in the darkness? It's because of this truth and this passage that I'm not ashamed to say tonight that I've given my life to preach the gospel and for God to use it wholly in any way that he would plan to use it. Now, of course, to be the most prepared for any vocation, it's paramount that one invests in an education that will train them to be the best that they can be. Tonight, I praise God for sending me here to Fairhaven Baptist College. As I stand here, there's an overwhelming feeling of gratitude that just swells my heart tonight. I look back and I know many of the people that invested into me, those that are here and those that aren't here, and I wouldn't have time to name them all. But I like to take time for just a few. There's an inspirational author and pastor by the name of William Arthur Ward, and he once said this, "Feeling gratitude but not expressing it is like wrapping a gift but never giving it." And it's with this idea of gratitude tonight that I'd like to close. First of all, I'm grateful for a school and a church here whose job is solely the training of young men and women to enter full-time Christian service. Secondly, I'm thankful and I praise God for a pastor here who I know stands on the truth and seeks to inspire young men as myself to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ. I'm thankful for every teacher and professor and every minute of time they've poured into my life to help me to be thoroughly furnished in the scriptures and with the wisdom to apply it. I'm thankful for a bus captain that, though I'm very hard-headed at times, he's taken 4 years to give me one of the most important lessons I could learn, which is selflessness and putting others before myself. And I'm also thankful for my family, many of whom are here tonight to support me. And I know that every step of the way, they've loved me, they've supported me to be the best that I can be at whatever it is that I do. But lastly, and most importantly, I'd like to thank an almighty, all-knowing, ever-guiding, and ever-loving God who has guided every step of my way here, and I take no glory from it tonight. I give it all to God that he's brought me here. Upon graduating tonight, I'm privileged and blessed to be able to work here at Fairhaven Baptist Church for another year until the Lord moves me on to whatever ministry it is that he'll call me to. Although I have many years of training and practical hands-on learning still ahead of me, my goal and desire one day is to preach the gospel in a land that's never heard the truth. Until then, I look forward to the further years of training and preparation and just the love and mercy that God has shown me, and I just pray he would continue to show it to me. Thank you.
All right, at this time, ushers, I'll give you a couple seconds to get prepared. I don't know if I warned you as far as the offering, but we're going to be taking an offering. Remember, and this is the graduation offering, in the bulletin we gave you, an insert, and that's just a couple of the projects that we're going to try to tackle this summer. We're trying to raise a little bit of extra money to do it. The students know this. In the dining room where we eat, some of the family members, you ate there last night, our carpet has been trampled upon, dribbled upon often, and so that carpet, we're going to try to replace it this summer. So we broke it down into different things. There's some gym seating we're trying to replace, and then the gym floor. We had a leak for a couple years in the gym, and it bubbled our floor, so it's taken a little bit extra money to repair that gym floor. So that's what this graduation offering is going to be taken towards. And so if ushers, if you want to make your way down, and as you remember, Dr. Vogelin mentioned at the beginning, the piece that the high school band is going to be playing is the sacred piece. I looked it up in the hymn book. The hymn that they're going to be playing is number 185. If you wanted to follow along as they play it, it's Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. I'm going to ask Rao Yoon to come and ask the Lord to bless as we receive this offering.
Lord, we thank you for tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for your many blessings. Thank you for the family and the friends that came to support the graduates. Do pray, Lord, that you bless them, guide them. Lord, that they would do your will. Pray that you bless this offering. Help us to have a good night. Bless tonight, Lord. Give you all the honor and glory for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and take our hymnal. If you haven't taken it yet, turn to number 185, and we'll sing through the three verses of this song. And as Pastor Dameron sort of mentioned, just so there's no confusion, you should know that if you do have to leave once the preaching starts, we'll have some chairs reserved in the back for you to sit in and not further disrupt by coming back to your seat there. Number 185, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken.
Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion City.
You may be seated. At this time, it's my pleasure to present to you the graduating class of Fairhaven Baptist Academy for the year 2016. Levi Armacost. Jessica Bollinger. David Kriegel. Jennifer Dameron. Abby Gross. Allison Gunzenhauser. Maggie Leek. John Olson. Esther Wright. Let's give them a round of applause. Now it gives me pleasure to present to you the graduating class of Fairhaven Baptist College for the year 2016. The following students will be receiving a Bible certificate. Cesar Chavez. Joseph Payton. The following ladies will be receiving a secretarial diploma. Carrie Brown. Caitlin Messing. Lydia Mitchell. The following ladies are receiving a Bachelor of Science in Elementary Education. Denise Howe. Jenny Hunt. The following ladies are receiving a Bachelor of Science in Secondary Education. Laura Ansley. Julia Gunzenhauser. Rachel McGovern. Shelby Payton. These ladies are receiving a Bachelor of Arts in Sacred Music. Rebecca Buckmaster. Lydia Clausen. Charity Van Raden. Calling men are receiving a Bachelor of Arts in Pastoral Theology. Josh Barzan. Robert Dupre. Jordan Karecki. James Sawamba. Shem Sylvester. Give them all a round of applause.
our speaker for our commencement service is Pastor Tom Fryman. I was glad that he could be with us last night. He did our closing chapel for the college and college students. He's apologized for all those mean remarks that he made against me. He's confessed those things, he's gotten right. So tonight he'll probably be a lot calmer, a lot more powerful, all right? But we've been good friends. He's been pastor at Cornerstone, here he comes, Cornerstone Baptist Church for about 36 years. He's a good friend. I was glad his wife, Penny, could be with us. And last night actually was an excellent, excellent sermon as he closed out our college year, the last chapel. And I know he'll be a blessing this evening.
Amen. Thank you. I appreciate that so much. I am honored to be a part of this commencement service here this evening. I think it's great that we can pause and we can recognize the accomplishments of these young folks as they prepared for the ministry and prepared for life. What it actually is, as a commencement service, it's also a celebration of accomplishment. Just think, you've fulfilled all of the requirements to be able to get your degree, but it's also a commencement service. And what that focus is, it's on the future. And what the expectation is that you'll do something profitable with the training that you've received. But you know what? When we talk about commencement, that's not just limited to the graduates that are here. It's actually every one of us, because every one of us has a future, and every one of us should face that future and with an anticipation of accomplishing something for the Lord. And so I want us to focus our attention on that this evening. If you will, take your Bible and turn with me to the book of 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 1 this evening. And I'll be reading a verse in just a moment. While you're turning there, I want to read something to you. This is from the Apostle Paul, and this is what he wrote. He said, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affection, even as their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also men with men, working that which..." Let me reread that. "And likewise also men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient." And then Paul lists some things in that chapter. Now, the Apostle Paul wrote that when he was in Corinth. He could look out a window and he could see everything that he talked about there being practiced in the society of that day. As we read it here tonight, we can look in our society and see the same thing all around us. These things are happening all around us. If I say this, but I want you to know that things are going to get worse. Did you know that 2 Timothy 3:13 says, "But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived." Now, I don't mean to sound like a prophet of doom, but what I'm saying is right. We live in depraved times. We live in wicked times. And yes, it is going to get worse. But I don't want you to get the wrong idea. You know what we need to be reminded of? What we need to remember is that no matter how dark the time becomes, it will not overcome the light. You know what the Bible says? Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. The work of God will go on, and the work of God will go on in this generation and every generation till the Lord returns. But who will do that work? I mean, Jesus said that I will be with you always. So there always had to be people there that Jesus could be with. And this is a promise. I want you to hear this. You know this. Your preachers preached it. You know it. Jesus Christ said that I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. You know what that's saying? Is that there will always be a time when God is building his church, when he's building his work. That's a promise by God. But who's God going to use in this generation? If you think about it, he can't use angels. God doesn't use angels to spread the gospel. God uses men. And unfortunately, today, we're facing a problem. There's a shortage of men. Men of God, men of character, men of courage, and men of conviction. Now, that's used in a general term. I'm not talking about males. I'm talking about men and women, young and old, that can fulfill what God wants us to do. It's all around us, the need. It's no secret that God is looking for such men. It says in Ezekiel 22, verse 30, "And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me in the land, that I should not destroy it, and I found, but I found none." Isn't that a sad statement? That God was looking for someone to fill in that gap, and there was no one to fill in the gap. There are other places. It says in Isaiah 66, 2, that to this man I will look, and he tries to find one. In Jeremiah 5 and 1, it talks about running to and fro in the streets and see if you can find a man. There is a need today for men, for women, young and old, to stand up for the truth, to stand up for the things of God. That's what the idea of standing is. That's the idea about filling in that gap, being a gaptist, if I can say that. You know what a wall is around the city? In ancient times, what that wall did is it protected that city. You know what it did? It kept the enemy out, and it provided protection for those that were in the city. You know, of course, that the soldiers, whenever they fought shoulder to shoulder. You know what that enabled them to do? To be able to protect the soldiers that were beside them and the ones that were behind them that were coming up. It enabled them to stand their ground. It enabled them to advance and defeat the enemy. Now, what we're talking about tonight is not cities. I know it's great that Nehemiah built the walls, but we're not talking about cities here tonight. We're talking about the work of God. We're talking about ministries. We're talking about people that need to serve the Lord. That's what we're talking about here tonight. And we need people to stand and fill in that gap because we want to keep the world out. We want to keep those forces of darkness out, and we need to stand against them. And we also want to protect those that are around us. We want to make sure that we can advance the work of God for our Lord. Now, the problem that we have is our ranks are thinning. Now, I don't mean this in a bad way, but what I'm saying is there are people that are being called home. People are dying. I know what the Bible says. Preacher, the Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the saints. I know that. I understand that. But you know what the Bible also says? The Bible also says that how art the mighty fallen in the midst of the battle. Not at the end of the battle, but at the midst of the battle. Getting older is a part of life. When I assumed the pastorate in Massillon, Ohio in 1980, you could talk about the cities in Ohio, and you could almost name a city and put Baptist Church or Baptist Temple beside it, and you know I'm telling the truth. And there was a good church that was there that was standing for God and doing something in almost every city in Ohio. But you know what it is? Today, all of those older men have died. They've gone on. And some of those churches are not even standing for God today. Hey, getting older is a part of life. It's going to happen. I know in my ministry. I know that in other ministries, that's what's happening. I know this also, that people fall by the wayside. But God's not the only one looking for men. Did you know that? The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8, it says that be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, talking about the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom may devour. Now, I don't know if this is true, but I tell you what, I do know that the Bible says that there's rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that repents. Do you think that there could be rejoicing in the realm of darkness over one servant of God that falls? Do you think that they rejoice over when someone falls by the wayside, when a preacher or ministry is destroyed because of immorality or destroyed because of doctrinal problems? Hey, I say this, you graduates,
You're looking forward to life. You know, you can look back over the time that you've been here, and there have been some, like that young lady mentioned, that have fallen by the wayside. But you know what's going to happen? Even in the ministry, you're going to see those that fall by the wayside. When I was in college, when I was in Springfield, Baptist Bible College in Springfield, one of my roommates from my first year and one of my roommates from my second year, at different times, different ministries. But you know what, Brother Ramos? Both of them sinned and fell. One of them had gone back home to his home church for a funeral service and saw one of his old girlfriends. And nothing good can come from that. His wife and family wasn't there. And he destroyed his family and destroyed his ministry. The other, there was a missionary. And he ended up destroying his ministry by committing immorality on the field. Don't think that even preachers are exempt from that. It's happening all around us. Those that are sinning morally, those that are sinning doctrinally, they're falling by the wayside. But you know what? And this is what we're going to fight in my church and what you're going to fight in this church. It's not those that fall for those reasons. It's those that just quit, those that give up. Now I'm not talking about leaving the ministry. I'm talking you can be in the ministry. You can be in church. Your body can be sitting on those pews. But what I'm talking about is losing that passion for God. You used to have a burden for people. You used to joy in the things of God. But now, just passing the times, thinking about those good old days. I mean, after all, we live in the last days. I mean, what can we expect? I mean, things are getting bad. And so what we do is we just sit back and wait for the Lord's return. Let's see if I can illustrate a point to you. Can you envision a line of men standing across the front of this auditorium? I don't know, 100 men standing shoulder to shoulder. And then I want you to visualize this. Four or five of them over there are removed. Two or three here, one there, one there, three here, five there, two over there, six over there, one there. And what you end up is gaps in the line. You understand what I'm saying? Now, what are we going to do? Now, what we could do is we could close ranks. And that's what happens. We could close ranks. But what about those ends? We're no longer what we used to be. I'll tell you what's better than closing ranks is replacements, is people standing up and filling in that gap. That's what I'm talking about here tonight. Replacements, men, women, young and old, to take their place standing in the gap. I believe that that's what the Lord's talking about in this challenge to us. I know this, that there are quitters. I know this, that there are skeptics that have affected our view of the work of God and has affected our views of the promises of God. You know what they say? They see things like this, that, well, those type of blessings are not for this time. If conditions were just better, we could see more success. This is a hard field. I mean, this is just my lot in life. This is the best that God can do with me. Hey, if Jesus Christ is going to build a church, why can't he build it with us? That's what I'm talking about here tonight. Hey, we know that the promises of God are real, but you know it's easy to say that God's going to take care of you when you're talking to someone who's having a problem. But I've noticed this great credibility gap in what we say and what we live like. When we see somebody going through problems and we say God's going to take care of you, but then when we go through problems, it's different. We cannot see how God's going to work it out. So it's woe is us, and we mope and we quit, and we lose that zeal that we once had. Brethren, these things ought not so to be. Now let me read a verse to you. I know your preachers asked me to respect the time limit, and of course I will. If you'll look at the chapter I asked you to turn to in 2 Corinthians, in chapter 1, I actually wish that we could actually go through the entire chapter, but time would not allow us to do that. I want you to look at a verse down here. Here's what it says in verse 20. It says, for all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us. Isn't that a great thought if you think about it? You know what he's saying there? That all of the promises of God in him, in Jesus Christ, are yes, are yea. And in him, amen. Do you know what amen means? Some of you don't. You know what amen means? It means let it be so, or make it so. That's what it means. Now, when it comes to using amen in churches, a lot of people don't have a clue of what they're doing. They're just making noise. Have you ever noticed this? These guys are saying, amen, amen. And if you listen to what they're amening, I heard this one time. Brother Vogel, I heard this guy get up and say, people are dying and going to hell. And this guy says, amen. He's saying, make it so. That guy don't have a clue of what's going on. You understand what I mean by that? But I tell you, preachers are bad about it too. But sometimes people in the pew, the preacher will be up there and he'll be preaching something. And then what happens is the preacher starts riding their hobby horse. And then it's amen. What it means is, preacher, you're agreeing with me. But actually, you know what amen is? It's saying to what God's word says, God, make it so. God, let it be. Amen. That's what the promises of God are all about. God gives us promises, and we trust them. We look forward to them. You know, we don't have a problem. We don't have a problem of believing that God did what he said he would do in the past. I mean, it's exciting to read some of the stories in the Old Testament. The story of Noah, the stories in Genesis and Exodus. When we get to heaven, I'm not sure if God's going to allow us to see what those situations were like. But don't you want to be able to see the look on Moses' face when he confronts them, in like in Exodus 32, when he comes down from that mountain, and they go, uh-oh. Don't you want to see what that was like? Don't you want to see what it was like when David went out and took care of the biggest bully in history? When that giant was there trying to defile God and defy the armies of Israel, and he went out there, David didn't have a bit of scare in him. He ran at that giant. Don't you want to see something like that? Don't you want to be able to hear Paul preach? Don't you want to be able to see Peter walk on the water? I mean, those things, when we get to heaven. I mean, when we hear those things in the Bible and we see them, we rejoice in those. Wow, that's good. God really did that. And we don't have a problem believing about what God's going to do in the future. I mean, we talk about the Lord's return. Our Lord is returning. Oh, shout hallelujah. And the people, they get goosebumps sometimes when they think about Jesus is coming again. Jesus is coming again. We don't have a problem about believing the promises of God in the future. But tell you what we do have is a problem with believing the promises of God in the sweet now and now. The things that we're facing today and the things that we're facing now. You know what it is? When we look at the situations of life, when we look at these things, what we do is we say, I can't figure out how this thing's going to come to pass. I mean, this doesn't make much sense to me. I don't see how it's going to work. And so because we can't figure out how God's going to work, we don't think it's going to come to pass. Let me give you an illustration of what I'm talking about. Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn back in the Old Testament to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18. In Genesis chapter 18, I think most of us are familiar with this story. I won't go into, for the sake of time, all the background information that's in it. But look at what it says in verse 9. It says, and they said, this is when the Lord and the angels, the Lord appears to Abraham, and he's going to tell him that him and Sarah are going to have a child. But here's what it says in verse 9. It says, and they said unto him, where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent door, which was behind him. You know what? That's just a nice way of saying she was eavesdropping, okay? She's there listening to what's going on. That's exactly what she was doing. It says that she heard what they said. Now, what that time of life was the normal course of life, that there was going to be conception, they were going to have a child, and then 9 months or a year from now, they were going to come back, and they were going to have a baby. They were going to have a child. Now, I want you to see what her reaction is. Now, it says in verse 11, now, Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. Then Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, and my Lord being old also. Hey, we haven't had a child yet, and we're not going to have no child. There's got to be something else that he's talking about here. He's got to mean something else. He cannot mean that we're actually going to have children. Now, what she was saying in her heart and her mind is, I can't see this happening. I mean, when's the last time you heard of a 90-year-old woman having a child, a 100-year-old man producing a child? I mean, and it says there that it ceased to be after the manner of women. She just couldn't bear children anymore. The time of conception was over. But you know what happened? Those angels, they confronted, and the Lord confronted her in what she does. Skip down again for the sake of time, down to what it says in verse 14. It says, verse 13, it says, to get the context here, and the Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh? Surely, or shall I of a surety bear a child which am old? Now look at this. Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. That's a promise. That's what God said. Now, let me show you the rest of the story, if you will. Would you turn over to the book of Romans? In Romans chapter 4, let me give you God's commentary on what happened there. In Romans chapter 4, it says, in order to get a setting here, he's using Abraham as an example of faith. And he says in verse 18, it says, who against hope believed in hope that he might be the father of many nations according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And I want you to see what it says in verse 19. It says, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. Look at verse 20. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Do you know that that's the one thing that God wants you to do in your Christian life? I don't know if it was here that I mentioned this, but when I first got saved, I was saved as a senior in high school, right before my senior year. And I was one of those dumb kids that when you get saved, you just believe everything the preacher said. I mean, you go to church. I wasn't raised in church. I had good parents. And the preacher would get up and say something. We had these guest speakers that would come in. And they would say, you know what the most important thing in the Christian life is? It's to memorize Scripture. So I'm memorizing Scripture. And then I hear another one. He comes in and says, you know what the most important thing of the Christian life is? Well, there's two of them, and it's praying every day. So I pray every day. Then another one comes in and he says, you know what the most important thing in your Christian life is? It's to read your Bible every day. And then another one comes in and says the most important in the Christian life is to give out tracts of witness every day. And I'm trying to juggle all these things. And this other preacher comes in and he says, you know what the most important thing in the Christian life is? And I almost want to say, oh, brother, another one. But you know what? What he said put every one of those other things in the proper perspective. He said, do you know the one thing that God wants out of you? The one thing that you're supposed to do is to glorify him. You've been bought with a price, therefore glorify God. Hey, guess what? When you exercise faith in what God has said, you know what you're doing? You're glorifying God. That God will do what he says. That God will keep his word. That's what it says. That he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Look at verse 21. I got it underlined in my Bible. Every Bible I own, this is underlined. It says in verse 21, and being fully persuaded that what he had, next word in your Bible, promised, he was able also to perform. That's what faith is. What God's promises are, that's what he'll do. I don't know if it was like this. When we get to heaven, we'll see that picture I told you about. He knocked out the side of the tent, if that's what they do. Took an X-Acto knife and cut out and said, this is where the nursery's going to be. I mean, he believed God was going to do it. He believed Sarah's going to have a child, so he's getting ready. You know, he goes down to Toys R Us. Well, they didn't probably have that. Camels R Us. And he went down there and he got some toys because he knew what God was going to do. He acted like it because he believed that that's what God was going to do. If God says that I'm going to build my church, then young folks, graduates, be part of it. Claim that promise of God. Folks of Fairhaven Baptist Church and the guests that we have here, claim that promise and make that a part of your ministry, a part of your church. If God, I want to be in that place where you're going to be building a church, God. I want to make my life count for you. That's what it's saying. And that's what it means about the promise of God. But we say, I don't know how God can do it. Doesn't matter what you know. Doesn't matter what you see. Doesn't matter how you figure it out. Amen. If God says he can do it, then he's going to do what he said he's going to do. When God makes a promise, he keeps it. I know sometimes we make promises and we mean well, but sometimes we don't have the ability to be able to keep our word on that. I've heard people say, I promise I'll pray for you every day, and they don't. They mean it because they love that person, but after a while they get used to the condition and it kind of melds into oblivion. Or maybe we promise our wives that we'll make sure that we'll do this, and financially we're just not able to do it. But God, when he makes a promise, it's well in his power to do it. Amen. I'll tell you something else about the promises of God. One of the young people, I don't remember which one it was, that when they gave their testimony, they talked about being saved. I don't know if you heard that in there, but what they said was the confidence that they had in God. They said that they were saved, and that when they died, they were going to be with God in heaven. That's a testimony. That's faith. You know why they can have that faith in God? Turn, if you will, over to the book of Titus. And I'm almost done. You don't have much faith in me. I didn't hear one. That's right, okay? Titus chapter 1 and verse 1. I told you that I was not raised in a Christian home. I wasn't. I was had good parents. I was raised down in Florida, and I got a chance to see what sin did in all my peers. I saw people that were drunks, were dope addicts, were immoral, and I'm so thankful God protected me. And I looked at all those things, and I remember I was in the Palm Beach Mall parking lot in West Palm Beach, Florida, and I said, if this is all there is to life, I'd just as soon be dead. There was just no purpose. You know what? God heard the cry of sincerity out of my heart. And what God did several months later is he brought four total strangers, teenagers, that came by my house and knocked on our door. And somebody from the church drove by and just happened to see that we had moved into the neighborhood and said, there's a teenage boy that lives in that house. And they were having a youth rally. And they came by to invite me to their youth rally. I was going to a rock concert in Miami, and I couldn't go to their youth rally. But they came back the next week, and they invited me to go to church. And I went, and I did what all heathen do in the morning. I slept in, but I came on Sunday night. And it was remarkable the way God, I didn't know where the church was. I didn't know the name of the church. I just knew it was near the police station. And I went over there, and there was some hippie walking up the street. I said, hey, is there a Baptist church around here? And he said, I don't know if it's Baptist, but there's a church up there to the left. Go down there. I think it's there. And that just happened to be the one. God put the right people in the right time. I went into the church service. They started early. I sat in the back because they had it roped off and one of those long buildings like that. And I sat in the back. I missed the song service. I probably wouldn't have stayed for it. I got in there right when the preacher started preaching. And he started talking about sin and righteousness and judgment. He got up there and talked about sin. I didn't need to be told I was a sinner with 3 points and an illustration. And to me, it looked like that guy had 100-foot fingers. He was doing this, and I was all by myself in the back. And you know what I thought? Everybody there, they know that I'm a sinner. Everybody there knows he's talking about me. And I sat there in the back. He gave an invitation, come forward. And I didn't. I stayed in the back. I was scared. These people were fanatics. I stayed in the back. And I told those teenagers when they came to the back, and I told them I kept my word, I was there. And they invited me to go out after church with them for what they called fellowship. Oh, I'd been out with guys, and I tell you what, they'd turn on you in a moment if it was you or them going to jail. But these people were different. There was something genuinely happy and contented about those people. I told my mother later on that week, I said, Mom, I'm going to go back one more time, and I'm going to hear what that's all about. I sat about right where you're at there, brother, and the preacher preached, it seemed like the same message about sin, righteousness, and judgment. But he said this. He said, how many of y'all know that if you died right now, you'd go to hell? I knew it. I knew I was a sinner. I think if we're honest, we all know that we're sinners. We might try to evade it. I'm as good as somebody else. And that may be the case, but are you good as Jesus? That's the standard that we're judged by. And the preacher said this. He said, he talked about how that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. He said, and God's got a gift for you. God wants to give you eternal life. Would you give us a chance to show you what the Bible says? And you know what I did? I made my way out of that pew, didn't know a person in the church, or those four teenagers, didn't even know their names, came up to the front, and a deacon in that church named Walt Russell, he took the Bible, we knelt down, and he showed me from the Bible that I was a sinner. He showed me how much that God loved me. He showed me, and I didn't understand everything about repentance and faith, but I knew that I was on my way to hell and that God loved me enough to save me. And I called on Jesus Christ with as much faith as I had. Now, you know why I know I'm going to heaven? Not because I'm arrogant. Look what it says right here in Titus chapter 1, verse 2. In the hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised. What God said, he's going to do. God said that he would give eternal life to those that come unto him. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I know that. I'll tell you what else I know. I know that if we want to make our lives count for God, we need to do just that. You graduates and you folks, you Christians, we need to come to the place where our testimonies show the world around us that we believe God. I'm just about done. I'm folding the papers up. You know that's time for the preacher to be done. Put it in my Bible. I'm getting a drink of water so I can keep going. I'm getting a drink of water just so that I can get a drink of water. You remember, and you can look at it later, it's in the book of Acts. And in the book of Acts, what happens is Paul is arrested, and he's going to be going to Rome. They happen to be in a port, and he tells them that don't sail because you're going to have problems. But the centurion that was in charge, he believed the captain or believed the owner of the ship and them more, so they went. And in the middle of their voyage, exactly like Paul said, that there came this great storm, Euroclidon, this great storm. And when you read about it in the book of Acts, Luke was there, and it says all hope that we should be delivered was gone. I mean, they were all afraid. They were all scared to death. And then Paul comes on the scene. You should have done what I said. Isn't that a great word of comfort? Did I feel like giving an invitation now? Yeah, I should have done what I said. But you know what he says? He said that an angel appeared unto him, and he said that no one's going to die. He said that everything's going to be fine. Oh, you're going to lose the ship. You're going to lose the everything on it. But there's not one person that's going to die. And he says this, fear not, for I believe God. May that be the case in us. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this time that you've given us to be able to gather here tonight. Lord, what a blessing, Lord, it is to see an accomplishment of these young folks that have finished, Father, their course. Lord, they've gotten diplomas, and they're looking forward to serving you. I pray that you'll keep your hand of blessing upon them. But, Lord, this school and this church was founded on the principle of the gospel, that we could take the gospel around the world. And so I pray that you'll use these workers in a special way. And, Lord, we know the dark times that we're in today. I pray that you'll manifest your power and your presence. And I pray that in our churches, that we can see the manifestation of your presence and power. And Lord, we can see a great difference in our community because of our churches and the people. But Lord, I pray for anyone here tonight that might not know Jesus Christ as Savior. That like me, Lord, and I knew that there had to be something more to life. And Lord, the circumstances of their life have brought them into this service. And I pray, Lord, that you can bless beyond the words that I said, but that, Lord, that they can see how much you love them and what you've done for them. I pray, dear God, that you'll bring them to the Savior. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Remain standing for prayer.
Father, now as we dismiss this service, we thank you so much for what we've heard tonight, the message, how we've been challenged to trust in your promises. Lord, your promise of eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the promises, Lord, that we don't have to fear in these times of trouble and turmoil and wickedness that our world is facing. Lord, we have hope. And Lord, if there's anyone here that doesn't have that hope, I pray that maybe they talk to one of us those who've invited them, Lord, just to get some assurance and some direction from you. Lord, we love you. We thank you for what you've done in the graduates' lives, and we're excited about what you have for them for their future. Pray that you'd use them in a special way. And Lord, just bless the time of fellowship as we part. We ask this all in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen.